I'm honored to be joined today by General David Petraeus. He's sharing with us today some of his insights on geopolitics, the age of technology, and the military in the national security context, and many other issues.
So, Kent, let me ask you a question,
sure,
if I could. I think one of the attributes that distinguishes a great company is not just identifying the right big ideas and then implementing them. It's also identifying what you thought were the right big ideas and then aren't working. Great companies say, you know what? This isn't what we envisioned. It isn't working,
right.
So let's move on.
They're having this many different opportunities, but also being focused on, you can't cover every bet. You have to concentrate. You have to pick the ones that have the most potential. Sergey Brin has a line I've used before. Ideas are easy, execution is hard. And the discipline that's required, if we're going to be successful, that's what it's going to take.
It is.
General, from your perspective, how are you seeing advances in technology changing geopolitics and changing the battlefield?
We're in an era of renewed great power rivalries. Geopolitics is back with a vengeance. The holiday from history, as they say, is over. Now all those barriers that were being reduced are going up, some of them very considerably. And so that's the world in which this extraordinary technological change is taking place. But I would submit that there are more plates in that tent right now than at any time, at least since the end of the Cold War. And then I'd also contend that they are far more complex in many respects, some of these different challenges, than they have been since the end of the Cold War. Maybe almost you could argue since the end of World War II. But technology is a critical enabler of the countries in this competition, much of it obviously propelled by your company, your great company, really, and several of the other really greatest of the technology companies in the world.
You see China investing a dramatic amount in the AI Plus program, hundreds of billions of dollars, et cetera. What's the best way for the United States to keep pace in that environment?
Well, certainly at the heart of it is what I would like to believe is the U.S. system, which provides incentives, opportunities, rewards that are so outscale that people want to come to the U.S. There is something that's truly unique about our system, about our universities, these, again, critical mass of intellectual talent, the ecosystems of venture capital, other investment that can be put to use in these, even the judicial experience, the legal experience, you know, all of this together makes our technology hubs the greatest in the world. But you need to have the government investing in research and development. You need to have the government enabling you to continue to attract the best and brightest from around the world.
Even beyond that, we need an energy infrastructure that allows us investing in next generations of energy.
Yep.
We are working hard on a regulatory structure that is pro-innovation and the like. And maybe even most importantly, beyond the innovation, we need the diffusion. We need to put this to these
no
tools
question
to work.
About it. You know, you made a great point. It's not just coming up with the big idea, it's actually implementing it. And it's the other use cases, it's all this. But I'd highlight again the enablers, actually, of AI. You know, I'm a partner in one of the world's greatest investment firms, KKR. We're big into energy generation, management, and transmission. I have a big question about whether we really will be able to provide the vast quantities of electricity needed by the end of this decade.
Just to stress that we are very bullish on all sorts of new kinds of alternatives.
Right.
Not just geothermal and wind and solar, but small nuclear. Yep. We have an investment in Oak Ridge, Tennessee that we hope to come online. Yep. So we're working throughout actually Virginia, PJM and others to try and re-engineer the grid in some ways.
Yes.
Because in addition to new sources of energy, we can use AI to make the grids more efficient.
Yep.
Significantly, and that's found energy essentially. So it is a little bit all of the above, not just new sources, but new ways of using
and transmission and management.
You've written a book about the modern age of conflict.
Yes.
How are you seeing technology changing the balance of power? What should we be investing in? What should we be concerned about?
Well, if you look at Ukraine, and if you've been following it from the beginning, the innovation and progress, and again, the application again, is breathtaking. How have they sunk one-third of the Russian Black Sea fleet without what we would regard as a navy? So how do you offset these enormous disadvantages? you innovate. And when you're fighting for your very survival, all of your tech heroes come home. They're actually serving in these units, by the way, mostly in civilian clothes, except what they're developing are the absolute bleeding edge of unmanned systems. They're also on the cutting edge of doing something we have spent billions to do and still haven't really perfected it. Somebody who built and sold several companies in Silicon Valley went to Ukraine immediately after the invasion, said, I'm here to help. He finds a way in which he can help, and it's to produce this particular product, if you will, which now is essentially Amazon-like for weapon systems, optics, components, all of this stuff that are used by companies that are supporting the effort or by actually military organizations. So they can use their credit card and it'll be delivered not within 24 hours, but it may take a few days to get to the front lines.
Maybe there's a lesson there for American military procurement.
Oh, I wish, because it is really hard to transform at the pace at which we should be transforming. It's understandable, but it's beyond frustrating, especially when you're in a time of war.
And as you were saying, the Ukraine has been remarkably nimble and agile in their innovation. They've done remarkable work on a lot of this. Google's early involvement in the first days of the conflict was primarily on the cyber side of things, where we had Project Shield, which was defending their websites, their government installations, and the like.
And people don't realize that the Russians threw everything at Ukraine.
Yes. Now, it does also show that the cyber battlefield is increasingly important. We're very focused on cybersecurity.
Sure.
We said Google is some of the most attacked websites in the world, but we also keep more people safe than any company in the world.
Yeah.
And now we're seeing in this era of AI, we had the first instance where we were able to detect and defuse a vulnerability that was about to be used in the wild by bad actors out
with
there.
With an algorithm?
With an algorithm.
A tool
called Deep Sleep, which is a new form of agentic AI, where we're actually training the tools to be able to identify and deal with problems that are out there. We're also expanding the AI dashboard, essentially, for investigations and awareness of the hundreds of different nation state actors that are up to cyber mischief and potentially worse than that. So it's a good example of how cyber conflict is not just between nation states, but also rogue actors, criminal actors, et cetera.
Oh, the different categories. Again, there are some out there that are trying to steal our information, steal our intellectual property, just aggregate so much information that you can connect dots later on and pull a digital needle out of a digital haystack. Of course, there are some countries that are actually vacuuming up encrypted data in the hope that when quantum arrives, they'll be able to decrypt it. There are others that are trying to put a finger on the scales of elections in US and Europe, et cetera. There are others that are just doing this for money.
It shows the cat and mouse game that we're all involved in.
Yep.
And
yep.
We're simultaneously pioneering work on quantum and work on post-quantum cryptography.
Yes.
We stay ahead of both sides.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, General, it's been a real pleasure to have your thoughts, your insights on all of these issues. Thank you very much.
Pleasure has been mine, Kent. Anytime. Thank you.